Good evening, and welcome to Mothers and Daughters Candid Conversations. I'm Gloria Walton, your host for the evening, and I am totally honored to be with you tonight. We took a week's vacation, and so we came back tonight with something strong. I have a wonderful guest tonight, and so that I really want him to do most of the talking tonight. And so I'm going to get right to introducing you to my guest. And that is none other than John C. Byler. Oh my God. When you hear John's story, he is not only an author, but he is a survivor. And he is the founder of the BISON Foundation. Now I know you're saying, well, what is the BISON Foundation and who is John? And you know, what's John all about? And, you know, why are we going to hear from John tonight? Well, let me tell you a little bit about John. Right before John comes on to share his story, when I said that he is an author, he is the author of You Look Great: Strategies for Living Inside of a Brain Injury. You Look Great: Strategies for Living Inside a Brain Injury. And tonight, I kind of stole this phrase from John. And so tonight we are going to talk about brain injury, traumatic brain injuries. And I am going to ask John if he would just come in. Our show may not be the complete hour. I want John to come and to begin to share about what traumatic brain injuries actually, what does it look like? I want him to share his story, and I want him to talk about reclaiming your brain. Come on in, John, and just introduce yourself and tell us about this traumatic brain injury.
Okay, can you hear me okay? I guess my life is the milestone is 2005, September 21st, 2005. At that time, I had been with Fidelity Investments for 11 years as an instructional designer, creating corporate training, really. And I was taking my middle son, Andrew, to his bagpipes lessons, practice, really. And we were hit at a high speed from behind on Route 495, which is outside of Boston. And we were driving a 93 Volvo, which is a very hard shell. And that guy hit us so hard, I didn't even see him coming in the rearview mirror. He just smashed the trunk right into the back seat. And we spun and ended up in the grassy area on the left side of the very three-lane busy highway with UPS trucks barreling down the road. It was a miracle that we landed safely as we did. And so I stopped the car and I turned to Andrew. I said, are you okay? And he said, I'm okay. Are you okay? Because I was, you know, going, oh my God. And I still stutter talking about it. Three sets of flashing lights appeared. There was an ambulance, and there was a fire truck, and there was a state trooper. Interestingly, the state trooper's name was Miranda, as in the Miranda rights. So the state trooper made sure we were okay, and the ambulance asked if we wanted to go to the hospital, but we both presented well at the time. My son Andrew sustained three broken vertebrae in his back, causing him pain to this day. Fortunately, no brain injury. My symptoms really started to unravel over the next couple days. I was finishing up a project for Fidelity. That Thursday and then Friday, I wasn't feeling well at all. By Saturday, I was taking my youngest son to a baseball game, and I called a friend of mine who was she got her training at Harvard Medical School, and I was talking to her, and she said, John, you've got to get to an emergency room. All right, you sustained a brain injury. So I went to the emergency room 3 days later, and I failed an informal neuropsych test, and so they had me take a CAT scan and then eventually an MRI. But sometimes a brain injury, it happens at the neuron level. And so these MRIs, you'll be fine, you know, no hemorrhaging. Thank God I didn't need brain surgery. But and that's part of the title of the book is you look great. And because after you hear that, to give you an idea of the scope of outpatient treatment I received at Spalding Rehabilitation Hospital in Boston. That's a Harvard Medical School teaching hospital. So I knew I was in very good hands. The doctor that I ended up with was a surgeon. He didn't need to do any surgery, but he said, at this point, you can either let time take its course or get a case manager. And so I got a case manager, and that led to me getting to Spalding and meeting my team of specialists. But you know, in that first year, my brain felt like it was full, like after a Thanksgiving dinner. I just couldn't take in the bright lights. Normally I wear these dark glasses to Zoom meetings and so on, because I haven't been sleeping well lately, or the past year really. And so I just a bit of a mess. So let me pause there, Gloria, and because that's the incident. So that's what led me to this place of disability. I'm on Social Security disability. I can't do what I used to do. And in fact, the federal judge said there isn't a job in the national economy I could do, which I've been fighting against, of course. And it led me to Kansas due to my wife and I separated after 30 years of marriage. And I came back to Kansas, where I was born, in 2012. And so it's been a matter of me kind of trying to get back on my feet again in terms of where I'm at with my recovery, because I still feel very fragile. My nerves are shot still. I mean, when you're hit from behind without warning, I had a brain scan recently. You and I talked about this brain scan, which I can talk more about. What concerned the doctor was that this one area of this brain scan said, you see that? He said, you're living life like you're standing in a road and a truck is about to hit you. You can't sustain that level of anticipation and fear. So I have to, that's where I think my faith comes in, Gloria, is that anybody in the world can let you down. Another driver can let you down. Somebody with a brick in his hand can let you down and crush your world. But there's something about the human spirit when God breathed life into us. That's what's indomitable. We talk about how the human spirit is indomitable. It's that holy breath from God that's indomitable. We mess it up all the time at a human level.
John, I want to say, please feel comfortable putting on your glasses, because you did ask me that. So yes, put your glasses on.
Well, I don't want to be standoffish. I do cry easily. I will give you a heads up on that. That's something that, you know, one of the topics I know we'll cover is pharmaceuticals. And early on after my crash, I cried easily, and the doctor said that it was inappropriate. And so that was the first. I had not been on medications. I was very healthy mentally before this crash. But then the first one was Celexa. And my theory is eventually I had to get off of Celexa, because I was experiencing what I was considering some very serious post-traumatic stress in the pit of my stomach. And my theory is, and I'll be happy to test it with the audience, is my theory is that this crying was a human emotion to a tragedy. If you deny a person the right to cry, that builds up to a fist, you know? And so eventually I had to get off of Celexa, but then what? And then when I came to Kansas, that's where they really ratcheted it up, because I saw a general practitioner. Look, if Harvard Medical School is getting some things wrong with the brain, your general practitioner in a small Kansas town will get some things wrong as well. I give him grace over that. But I got to tell you, I was injected with Valium, and then prescribed three things at once: Xanax, Clonopin, and Seroquel. What I should have asked is, doctor, are there any human clinical trials to justify these four things you're doing to me? And I didn't think to do it, Gloria, because he had a white lab coat and a stethoscope around his neck. You see? The authority figure. I'm telling you, I'm the beneficiary of some aspects of Western medicine. But these drugs, to kind of summarize that, I would say that it was hellish to be diagnosed to need it because I was in a bad shape. He said that was like an emergency, like an elephant gun. And it was hell to be on it. And then it was hell to try to get off it. So where's the quality of my life? You know? So I fortunately haven't been on any pharmaceuticals in a number of years. So I've started over. I'm not taking anymore. Even to sleep, and maybe I need to sleep, but I am very suspicious of. I just have decided I just won't go on anti-anxiety or antidepressants again, because I just think that God, these are part of the human condition, some of this, and that God accounted for that in what He created grows out of the earth, and so I'm looking for more natural therapies right now, and basic things like deep breathing.
Yeah, that sounds good. Deep breathing. You know, John, this conversation is dear to me because I shared with you that in 1983, on my way back after vacationing and removing some groceries from my car, a gentleman about 6 feet decided that he wanted the keys to my brand new car. Me, now, in hindsight, I should have just given him the keys. But instead, you know, I gave him a little conversation and he hit me in the head with a brick. And so I understand the consequences or the aftermath of having a head injury. You know, for our audience, I'd like to identify what Google, okay, identifies, and I Googled it so that I could have some terminology for our viewers, and I want to thank those that are on Facebook now viewing our conversation, John. And no, we did not plan to have on the same colors, guys. John, maybe it's the head injuries that we have, huh? But you know, John, this traumatic brain injury is actually defined as having a sudden injury that causes damage to the brain. And when I thought about sudden, I mean, it's just as your car accident, just as my this guy that decided to hit me in the head. But then I began to think even more about all of the other ways that we could have this traumatic brain injuries, and who is really at risk of having this. I mean, I hear your story and I've heard and I'm familiar with your background. Just for our viewers, just tell us once more, what were you doing? What was your quality of life before this accident?
The quality of my life was very high. I lived in Harvard, Massachusetts. It's a beautiful town west of Boston. My wife and I have three sons. I was my active in my church, Lutheran church. The quality of my life was very high. And I remember, Gloria, in the year or so before the crash, I did pray two things in particular. I did pray about my marriage. We weren't having difficulties. I just was praying about my marriage. And I also prayed about my job. I was good at it. I was well thought of and it paid well. But Lord, is this what you want me to do with my talents and my time? And that car crash kind of answered both questions or addressed them in some way. Not gently either. And that's been a road of discovery about what now? You know, when all of this is taken away, when all of it's taken away and you have to land on your feet, well, fortunately here in Kansas, I'm so connected to this state and so connected to this town. My grandparents met here on both sides, my mother and my father. There's two farms in this area. One was owned by my great-grandfather on my mother's side, and the other was owned by my great-grandfather on my father's side. I belong in Heston. X marks the spot in Heston. I'll be buried next to my mother in Heston. My mother knew it had to be Heston. My mother passed away 5 years ago, but we had time. We had time to catch up. We had time. I read to her as she was dying. So praise the Lord for that, that I had this precious time with my mother. And there are other things that couldn't be possible. I remarried 2 years ago.
Congratulations.
And so we're really starting over here. But I'm surrounded by strength, just so you know that. I am surrounded by strength here.
That's so awesome. You know, John, I want to talk about the risk of having a sudden head injury. I think about our seniors, you know, how they, and I'm actually experiencing this with a family member that's constantly falling and recently fell and hit his head. With my background of child protection services, the shaken baby syndrome, you know, it comes to mind as well, that because it injures a child's brain. But because of what I do now, John, I want to talk about the impact of long-term incarceration on the brain. What's your thoughts?
The way I would put it is that unlike a shoulder injury or a knee injury, the brain has a mind of its own. The brain, people, you hear different statistics, but generally most people recover. Most people recover fully. Let's say it's 15% that don't. 15% of the entire population is a lot of people. And I didn't get better. I got worse. I unraveled. And so we're trying to ravel me up again, trying to patch me up. But I will say this. There's a word that I bring to support group meetings. The word is neuroplasticity. Neuroplasticity, and that is the brain's ability to heal itself. The brain, let's say something is difficult for me in speech. The brain will find ways of communicating that thought in other ways. It's sort of like water running down a hill. It will find its way down eventually. And we have to find ways of guiding it, of encouraging. I'll give you the example of stuttering. My speech language pathologist, Rick Sanders, he was my most valuable player. Even though on my team, I had a superstar neurologist. He literally wrote the book on neurology. He's the senior guy at Spalding and Harvard Medical School. His first name is Ross. And his last name is Zafont, Zafonte. He was my attending physician for a number of years, and he wasn't taking new patients. So neuroplasticity, it doesn't have a predictable trajectory. Your recovery, it could get better in a month, you could get better in 10 years even, and if it is your 1983 your incident, and look at you now. Gloria, what couldn't you do, let's say, for the first year after something like that?
Oh, well, I was out of work for a short time, and I had to get an MRI every year, and my balance was off. And so sports-wise, I couldn't play sports for a short time. Only recently, after you and I had this conversation, did I revisit what I could and couldn't do during those times. One thing that bothered me most, this is a little, is I couldn't grow hair in a particular spot in my head, you know, because of the injury. And so, I mean, that may be a little vanity talking, but as a woman, you know, not being able to grow hair, those things really affect my self-esteem for a short time. It's like, oh, you know, I have long hair every place except this spot. So, but I mean, there's an answer to that as well. not only this conversation, John, not only did it remind me of myself, but aneurysms. You know, I've come to know families where they've lost loved ones because of aneurysms. And now Alzheimer's and dementia, you know, those are all brain related. And so I wanted to talk a little about that and move into the work that you do with veterans.
Well, the work I do with veterans is more aspirational than actual at this point. I did go see the head of volunteer services over at Dole Medical Center in Wichita. And you know they're funded because they're always building stuff, you know. But I don't have a high degree of confidence that our veterans are being, I'm afraid that the go-to solution for the Rolodex of needy veterans is the pharmaceutical solution. And so I offered up myself. I serve on the board of the Brain Injury Association of Massachusetts. They asked me in 2009, before my book even came out, because I was doing public speaking in the Boston area to graduate schools. And sometimes I lose my train of thought, too. That happens a lot, the train of thought. Just remind me again, Gloria. Sometimes I lose my thread.
It's okay. Why don't you tell us, because the BISON Foundation, in which you're the founder, is about strategies for living with brain injuries, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Can you share some of the strategies?
Yeah. So veterans are when I was finishing this book in 2011, I saw that they cited the suicide rate as 22 a day. And 10 years later, I'm still hearing that same number, 22 veterans a day. And I felt I knew why. I thought I finished my book in July of 2011. Then I read the statistic that the suicide rate had overtaken the combat rate. That's a crossover. Now who won the war? Okay. So I pulled the book out from publication and I spent the next 5 months really doubling down on depression and suicide the last chapter I expanded. It's called Living This New Life, because I wanted it to have that street credibility among our veterans coming back from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. So as far as what I'm doing for the veterans, I finished the book, what I want is to offer hope, and I can be very practical in how I would want the BISON Foundation to offer hope. Pinned to the top of our Facebook page are two projects, Project One and Project Two. Project One is called the BISON Braid, and that's where we hire, because I don't want to depend on volunteers, God bless them, but sometimes volunteers can be unreliable. I want to have on staff at an aspirational wage, let's say $15 an hour, three people who come into a shut-in's home, because I've been in homes, and they're embarrassed and ashamed at living in squalor. They know it, but perhaps their executive functioning has been damaged, and they can't, and that's part of my challenge, is disorder. So the BISON Braid, three people come into someone's home, and the first person is the bureaucrat, we'll call him. He takes care of all the paperwork, the bureaucracy of this injury, the medical files, the insurance, the taxes, the personal finance aspect, kind of gets all that responsibility falls to the healthy partner, and the divorce rate is way in the 90%. Okay, so the bureaucrat, we need the bureaucrat. The second is the feng shui, the physical setting, restoring dignity to people's living conditions. And that's gonna take probably more than one person, where you roll up your sleeves and you clean the bathroom and you clean the kitchen and you provide nutritious meals in the freezer. The third person, you would think that of all the three, you could get volunteers, but this is the interpersonal person who makes eye contact with our participant in the program, makes eye contact, looks through their photo album, plays dominoes with them or cards, no screen time, just really is trying to establish a friendship relationship. So that's my lifeline to the shut-ins. And I expand the definition of shut-ins to include not just traumatic brain injury, but the elderly. Elderly care very much fits into this. And then the second project, number two, is and they're not mutually exclusive. We can go to them, and if they're able, they can come to us. And I'm working with people here in the Wichita area to design the perfect 21-day retreat. I chose 21 days because it's a kind of a holy number, 7 times 3. But that to me felt like the minimum amount of time where you could actually expect to see some improvements. Okay, so these participants would come to the retreats with all their paperwork and bureaucracy, and we would work with them during their time here. But we would also establish a baseline of nutrition that everybody needs to be on, and then kind of the customization at the top. So for example, one person might have Parkinson's or another kind of neurological disorder. We all need the same basic level of nutritional care, which the Bison Foundation would provide, but also a very customized treatment plan. And that's really the holy grail in the business I'm in neurotrauma rehabilitation. Two very important aspects of what I want to be a part of, and that is the accurate diagnosis. Okay, a lot of terms get thrown around. Somebody's moody and they call them bipolar. Well, out come the medications, you know. So to get an accurate diagnosis, and I'm working with a doctor in Wichita on brain mapping. We can talk about that sometime. It's more subtle than really anything. And the second aspect is that customized treatment plan. So you and I have had neurological issues, right? But the customization, you know, and that's where we consider things like the brain chemistry, dopamine, serotonin, those things. And I got to tell you, if I'm bitter about anything, I'm bitter that I don't know if I'll ever get my brain chemistry back.
Wow. God bless you. John, talk about your faith during this time.
Okay. I became a Christian as a late teenager. And I grew up in Hong Kong. As a son of Methodist missionaries, I grew up in kind of a refined household. The words out of our mouth, but then from Hong Kong we moved to New Jersey, where I learned new words, and everything was available to us because we were just minutes away from New York City. So I had an experimental high school experience, let's call it. But then I became a Christian through the Nazarene Church in New Milford, New Jersey. Church of the Nazarene, Pastor Charlie Rizzo was a great guitar player in the 70s, and he baptized me, and then fast forward to Massachusetts, ended up in High Liturgy Lutheran. I was actually president of the congregation and one of the liturgists. So I've taken my faith seriously for a long, long time. When I came home from the car crash, for that first year or so, I had to separate myself from my family. I had to be in a dark, quiet place all the time. So, and I wasn't sleeping. Sometimes I would be in my closet just for some dark and quiet. Sometimes in the back seat of my car in the driveway for dark and quiet for hours. And I was praying with every breath. I have had a very intense kind of quiet discipleship where I throw it back in his court. I said, Lord, here I am. And with every breath, you know, I would breathe out the Lord's Prayer, thinking about every word. Breathing out, Lord, help me, save me, I give up, I surrender. And the way I would characterize my formative faith during those years is the word surrender. That's what faith was for me. It was surrendering to my destiny, whatever that was. Yeah. And so when I started to make improvements and accomplish some things by writing this book over 5 years. It took 5 years with my co-author to write this book. It's 420 pages. And at the core of it is a model, because I was an instructional designer called the Brain Injury Recovery team model. It's a team effort. It's not a superstar neurologist who's going to get you better necessarily. It's that team of clinicians. And so as I was finishing the book in 2011, I realized, you know, I'll bet there's such a thing as a brain injury conference. So I looked it up. Sure enough, I applied to the three most prestigious ones. I got into all three, just like that. I knew I was onto something because I called it the brain injury recovery team model, colon, an interdisciplinary approach to neurotrauma rehabilitation. And so what one of the things that will characterize the BISON Foundation is our leading with the arts, music, theater. Let's not forget our hands, because our brains might be damaged, but I, as you know, I play guitar. I played guitar when I was 15. I played guitar through college, but it was kind of on a shelf during my professional years. Didn't come up much. Now that I'm in Kansas, I remember one night taking a late night walk, one of many, and I was talking to the Lord about my friends who spoke in tongues. And I said, Father, what's that about? I don't have that with you. And I felt the Spirit say, I don't hear voices. I felt the Spirit say, you're a musician. Those are your tongues. Communicate with me through your guitar. And I got to tell you, every time I touch this guitar, it's I'm not just going through scales. I'm communicating. And in there are ways where I'm more fluent in the guitar than I am in actual English.
Well, I've heard you play, and you're a phenomenal guitar player. Yes. You know, I'm reading from one of our viewers, Ellie.
Ellie Kabonga.
Yes, yes, yes. I want to shift the conversation here. I thought I would be able to share some pictures. You've been called. You have so many assignments, and you've taken up a new assignment, and that is to address hunger in Uganda. And the photos touch my heart, John, I have to tell you. And our conversation is why I said I want to be a part of your campaign. Now, you know, when I read, and I have it here, what you received from one of the pastors where they talked about the lockdown because of the COVID and the lockdown, the second lockdown, and the scarcity of food. I mean, we kind of experienced that here as well, but you're talking about a country that needs our help. And so I pledge to help you with that campaign. And I wish that I could share the photos because they were very, very touching. And it's Uganda and another country. Yes, yes, yes. And so for our listeners and for those that are viewing this recording, and what happens is for those that may not catch it now, they will go back in there on their own time and review this conversation and make comments. And so I will let you know if anyone wants to join us in this effort. You know, I'm kind of like a sucker for a cause. But it's a great cause anytime that you can do something to help. And we are believers, and we know that we've been called to help. I'm a servant, you know, and so I look forward to working with you on that initiative. Now, John, I don't want to keep you here, but I did want you to address incarceration. Because we had the conversation about the brain and long-term incarceration, and you being an expert in the field, can you just talk about that a little?
Yeah. As long ago as 10 years ago, so I would have been like 5 years into the injury, I met a woman who was doing a lot of research on incarceration. At the time, she was researching Guantanamo Bay. And she was sending me a lot of research. I was like her only friend, I think, one of her few friends. She sent me a lot of information. Frankly, I haven't heard back from her in about 6 months. And my fear is that she passed away. But she and I spent many hours on the phone talking about the research being done on the damage to the brain when you're in a cage, that which is a prison cell. And what I've learned is that if you didn't have a traumatic brain injury before you went into jail, you know, if that wasn't the cause of your, if you were acting out or doing something that was because you had a brain injury, not that they test for that, you either did a crime or you didn't, right? But let's say you have a healthy brain and you're in jail. Well, over time, that kind of inhumane treatment, I would call it cruel and unusual punishment. You know, Gloria, a couple of years ago in particular, I remember it was Christmas time, and I was praying, and I said, well, who's suffering a lot right now? And I thought, mothers in jail, mothers without their children. And so I looked into where there's a women's prison in Kansas, and there's exactly one in Topeka. And so I looked into that, and you know who's doing a lot of great work with them is the Methodist Women Organization. My mother was part of a Methodist Women Organization. So I thought that there's a field for service for me. You know, I do readings at a retirement home here in Kansas, and I here in Heston, and sometimes I bring my guitar and I spend time with them. But that's something that's a very simple ministry. I could help somehow, but incarceration when you think about the responsibility that a governor has. Let's talk about the governor of Kansas, Governor Kelly. What I want to do is start a campaign to alert her. You know, I don't want her to sleep well at night, knowing that there are men and women under her care. And whoever thought privatization of the prison system was a good idea really underestimated the benevolent nature of American capitalism. Okay, that was a bad idea. Because, well, I don't even have to list the reasons why that's a bad idea. I'll leave it to your imagination. So I want to sound the alarm. And so what does prison reform have to do with the Bison Foundation? Well, it's trauma. It's trauma, and that emotional trauma eats its way into the brain, and now it's personal. Now they're in our herd, and that's how I treat the Bison Foundation. We're a herd, and if you join us, and if you're part of our herd, you're the focus of our fundraising. The focus of the fundraising isn't to buy a building, although that should happen. The focus of the fundraising is those two projects. To fund, I don't want these great treatments that we're designing to be just for the wealthy. I want I have the first line of targets, and these are friends of mine who I have lost so many friends, Gloria, either to suicide, neglect. I'm running out, and so I take this very personally because I fit the profile of someone who maybe should have given up a while ago.
Well, John, there's so much we could talk about, because when I think about, you know, trauma, and in my community where there's a lot of gun violence, you know, I think that type of trauma also affects the brain. Yeah. But this is not the conversation. For us to have that, you and I will engage in that conversation. And I like how you said that you don't want your governor to sleep at night because of the incarceration issues. Well, we'll have that conversation as well. But at this time, John, I just want to say thank you. Thank you for sharing your time with us tonight. Thank you for your information. And, you know, for, again, to our viewers, both now and for those that will view later, you can contact John. Don't overwhelm him, but TBI Strategies on Facebook, because, you know, during our conversation, he received over 32,000 emails. Oh, my. And so you can reach out to him, and he or his administration, someone will eventually, I'm saying eventually get back to you. Okay, eventually get back to you. Just be patient. I know that there's a lot of questions pertaining to this conversation, John, but we can't do it all in one sitting. And so I'm going to say thank you again. This is Mothers and Daughters Candid Conversation, and I have been honored to be your host tonight, Gloria Walton, and my special guest, John C. Byler. Please, John, is your book still available?
Yes, it's on Amazon.
Okay. You look great. Strategies for Living Inside a Brain Injury is on Amazon. And again, you know, we have the author here, John C. Byler. Come on, guys, purchase the book. It's filled with information. John, I'm buying the book because you've awakened some questions in me that I'm definitely going to purchase your book and read it. And I just want to say thank you again. And to your lovely wife, tell her I said thank you because she encouraged you to come on. And she's a nurse, right?
Yes, that's right.
Awesome. Well, thank you. And I know that Kansas is good for horseback riding.
Anytime.
Thank you. And John, we'll talk soon, okay?
Okay. Yeah, I look forward.
Yes. Good night. And thank you. I want to say thank you to those that are viewing now. Walter May, Sharon, Cynthia, Ellie, and all of those on our Facebook Live. Thank you for viewing. And again, this is Mothers and Daughters Candid Conversation, Gloria Walton and John Byler. Good night.